Hello, anatomy and physiology students. Welcome to your virtual electrocardiography lab. This is part one of three different videos which are going to teach you the basics of what the different waves mean in electrocardiography. That's the first video. The second video is going to tell you how to use the live core cardiomonitor to record ECGs or EKGs. And the third video is going to teach you how to use ImageJ to digitally measure the time periods between the different segments, waves, and intervals. So this is that first video. So let's first talk off about what is an electrocardiograph versus what is an electrocardiogram. Well, it's similar to the words telegraph and telegram. Remember, a telegram is something you used to get that would be transcribed from the little dots and dashes that somebody using a telegraph would produce. So by the same token, this machine right here is called an electrocardiograph, and this printout is called the electrocardiogram. All right, before we go on to talk about the electrical activity of the heart, I want to say something about leads. Now, leads are basically measurements of electricity coming off the body. The heart, as it depolarizes, will generate electrical activity, which can be detected by electrodes. And we attach generally two or more electrodes to the body to detect this activity. When you go to the gym and you're holding onto those sensors on the treadmill, that is a very simple electrocardiograph, and it's using that information simply to determine your heart rate. And we're going to do that today using something called the live core cardiomonitor, and it's a simple two electrode ECG, and so we're only going to be looking at electrical activity between the left and right arms, and so that will be limb lead number one. But keep in mind, if you go to a hospital, they're going to have many more electrodes generating many more leads, and that'll give us a much more in-depth look at the electrical activity of the heart. Okay, so we need to say something about the heart, and the heart is autorhythmic. And what that means is that unlike skeletal muscle, it generates its own electrical impulses. So it's autorhythmic, and that autorhythmicity is due to these nodes we have here, one of which is called the sinoatrial node. So the sinoatrial node is the pacemaker node of the heart, and it's the pacemaker because it depolarizes under most circumstances the quickest, around 80 to 100 beats per minute. Now, that can be controlled extrinsically, for example, by the vagus nerve. The vagus nerve is a parasympathetic nerve that innervates the heart and basically says, you know, chill out, man, quiet down. And so it can slow down heart rate. But we also have cardiac accelerator nerves, which are sympathetic, which speed up heart rate when we're really nervous, upset, or we're exercising a lot. So keep in mind that there's an intrinsic pathway for regulating the heartbeat, and that's through our SA and AV nodes, but there's also an extrinsic pathway, and that's through our cardiac accelerator nerves and also our vagus nerve. So in the image at right, you can see the different nodal tissue in the heart as well as the conductive tissue. Now the nodal tissue includes the SA node and AV node. This is where depolarizations actually occur. All the other tissues in here that are indicated basically conduct that electrical activity to the apex of the heart and then up the sides of the heart. So let's go through the sequence of events. Now we said the SA node is the pacemaker because it depolarizes the fastest under normal circumstances. And again, that's usually around 90 to 100 times per minute, and that can be modulated through our vagus nerve. So the SA node depolarizes, and that depolarization travels down the right atrium right there. It reaches our AV node or atrioventricular node, where there's a delay of about 1/10 of a second. And then that information, that depolarization, it's transmitted by the AV bundle and down the left and right bundle branches, which travel through our interventricular septum. And then that information or that depolarization is going to be transmitted up the outside of our ventricles by our Purkinje fibers. Now remember, these depolarizations are not contractions. They're what's going to lead to contraction. So in general, depolarization happens, and then a split second later, or split fractions of a second later, there's going to be contraction. So this whole process can actually take place in about 0.22 seconds, or 2/10 of a second. So it's a relatively quick pace of depolarization, and that's important because under normal circumstances, the heart may only need to generate one beat per minute. But if we're in situations where there's a lot of demand on the heart, for example, heavy exercise, we have this ability to generate a cardiac reserve and have many more heartbeats than normal and generate a higher than normal cardiac output to account for that higher than normal metabolic load. All right, now that we've covered the elements of the intrinsic conduction system of the heart, let's go talk about the electrocardiogram. Now remember, the electrocardiogram is basically measuring the electrical activity in the heart, and there are three main waves we're going to identify: the P wave, which is indicated in red, the QRS wave, which is next, and then our T wave. But we're also going to talk about these segments and intervals as well. Now, the boxes here that make up our electrocardiogram indicate time. One big box is 0.2 seconds, and one little box is 0.04 seconds. So you can see that there are five little boxes in one big box, so 5 times 0.04, that's right, comes out to 0.2. And it's very important to know what the times are for each of these waves and segments. So the first wave you see on the left-hand side is going to be the P wave, and the P wave indicates atrial depolarization. Okay, when the atria depolarizes, and that is caused by depolarization of our SA node. What you can see here is it's about two boxes, and each box is 0.04, so that should be 0.08, not 0.8 as it says above, 0.08. Okay, next we have something called the PQ interval, and this is something that includes the wave, so from the beginning of P to the beginning of Q. So in this case, it looks like it's about four boxes, so that's 4 times 0.04, which is 0.16. And then we have our QRS complex. This is a very diagnostic wave, easy to recognize, and this indicates ventricular depolarization as that charge travels from our AV node down our left and right bundle branches and then up the Purkinje fibers. Okay, you can see it's about two boxes here, so again, 0.08 seconds. And then we have an ST segment. Segments do not contain a wave, whereas intervals do contain a wave. So the ST segment is from the end of the S and then to the beginning of T, and this is the period when the ventricles are entirely depolarized. And so we can see it's about three boxes or 0.12 seconds. And finally, we have our T wave. The T wave here is the period where we have ventricular repolarization. And again, you can see that this wave is about four boxes in diameter, so 4 times 0.04 would be 0.16 seconds. Now, what I'd like you to realize is depolarization does not necessarily equate to contraction. They don't occur precisely at the same time. So take a look at the electrocardiogram here. We had our P wave, right? That was atrial depolarization. But you can see that atrial contraction, which is indicated in blue, doesn't happen until we're into the P wave itself. Same with ventricular contraction. Remember, we had ventricular depolarization, which was our QRS complex, which was a very kind of short wave that only lasted about 0.08 seconds. But you can see that ventricular contraction goes on for much longer. In fact, it goes on up into the point where we're starting to have ventricular repolarization. So we can see three events on here electrically. We can see atrial depolarization, ventricular depolarization, and then we can see ventricular repolarization. So what's missing? Well, we can't really see atrial repolarization. And why can't we see it? Well, because it's such a small electrical event next to the ventricular depolarization, and that's a large electrical event, so it kind of just masks what's going on in there. But suffice it to say, somewhere around in here, we're also having repolarization of the atria as well. Okay, last but not least, I'm going to talk about something called a TP interval. Now, this is the time between the end of one T wave and the beginning of the next P wave. And this is variable. It depends on the heart rate. Right? If somebody is very relaxed and not exerting themselves, we can expect them to have a heart rate of somewhere between 60 and 80 beats per minute. On the other hand, if they are running cross country or something like that, we can expect them to have a heart rate of somewhere between 120 and 150 beats per minute. In this case, if the heart rate is beating much faster, we're going to expect a very, very small TP interval, whereas if they're relaxed and not exerting themselves, they're going to have a longer TP. Okay, last but not least, we want to talk about normal versus abnormal EKG tracings. Now, you are students. It is not your job nor your privilege to decide what is normal and abnormal. That is the job of a cardiologist. Suffice it to say, however, we should expect to see a P wave, a QRS wave, and a T wave for each waveform pattern. And if we don't, we can probably say that's abnormal. So up top, we can see the normal pattern, P wave, atrial depolarization, QRS, ventricular depolarization, and T wave, ventricular repolarization. What we can see in the middle here is that we're missing a P wave. So for some reason, the SA node has become damaged, and we're not always getting that P wave, and that results in something called a junctional rhythm. And finally, down below, we can see something as a result of heart block. Here's where we have the SA node is firing correctly, but we have an interruption in flow between the SA and AV node. So we don't always have a QRS after a P. We might have P, and then nothing, and then P, and then a QRS. So in either of these two cases, the doctor might consider installing a cardiac pacemaker in these patients. Now, in addition to classifying dysrhythmias, which we looked at previously, we should talk about other irregularities in heart rhythm. Okay, in addition to having missing wave patterns and things like that, we can have a fast heart rate or a slow heart rate, which is indicated on our electrocardiogram. So what we have up top here is something called bradycardia. Brady means slow. So bradycardia is a heart rate where we have less than 60 beats per minute, and this is abnormal. It can be pathological, but it can also be an indication of somebody that's just really healthy. And a lot of really well-tuned athletes will see their resting heart rate while they're at rest will be lower than 60 beats per minute, and it's just an indication of how physically fit they are. On the other hand, tachycardia is a higher than normal heart rate. Now, normally, if you're sitting here in the classroom, not exerting yourself, you expect your heart rate to be between 60 and 80 beats per minute. If, on the other hand, it's 100 beats per minute or 120, that is classified as tachycardia, and that would be cause for concern. When is tachycardia not a cause for concern? Well, if you've just been exercising, if you just watch a scary movie or something like that, that would be a normal time to have tachycardia. And finally, fibrillation is a very, very bad sign. This is when we can't really decipher individual P waves, QRS waves, and T waves, and that could be an indication that we might be having a myocardial infarction or a heart attack.